Good morning, members. This is the appointed time and we have a quorum. So let me welcome all of you to the Subcommittee on Issues Relating to the Silver Age Card under the panel on welfare services. We have three items that are really close to the hearts of members. Namely, one, poverty situation of persons aged 60 to 64 in Hong Kong and measures to assist these persons. Two, consumption patterns of persons aged 60 to 64 in Hong Kong and business opportunity of the Silver Age market. And three, progress of incorporating persons aged 60 to 64 under the government public transport fare concession scheme for the elderly and the eligible persons with disabilities. So these are all issues of our concern. And we have invited the administration to come and give us a briefing. Let me first invite the administration to come in. We have Mr. Ho Kai Ming, Undersecretary for Labour and Welfare from the Labour and Welfare Bureau, and also Ms. Reddy Ng, Principal Economist 3, Office of the Government Economist, Mr. Jonathan Ng, Senior Statistician from the Census and Statistics Department. So without further ado, I will invite the administration to walk us through the paper. And meanwhile, there is an information prepared by the LegCo Secretariat for members' reference. So I'll give the floor to the administration and then I'll open the floor for members to ask questions. The administration's paper is CB(2), 1212/2021(01). Mr. Ho, Undersecretary. Good morning, Chairman. Well, for information relating to 2020, we're still collating the information and the information won't be available until the third quarter of this year. So we are looking at the figures in 2019. In relation to the situation age 60 to 64, the poverty rate declined slightly by 0.1% by 0.1 percentage point, and the size of poor population increased slightly by 3,500 persons. And with the measures put in place, we were able to reduce the poverty rate by 6 percentage points. In 2019, comparing to 2018, the poverty rate increased slightly to 17.7% by 0.3 percentage point, but it's smaller than the increase of 0.9 percentage point in the overall post-intervention poverty rate. As for the labour force partition rate for this age bracket, there's been an increase, and for the various poverty alleviation measures in relation to the recurrent cash and other benefits, the poverty rate for the age bracket mentioned was lower in 2019 than the previous years. And as mentioned in the paper, we set out the major socioeconomic characteristics of the households with members aged 60 or 64, and we're happy to take questions from members. Thank you, Mr. Ho. I'll see if members have questions on the paper titled Poverty Alleviation of Persons Aged 60 to 64 in Hong Kong and Measures to Assist These Persons. Any questions from members? Well, while members are pondering the questions, what questions to ask, let me ask Undersecretary the following. I think that there is a need to further improve the way the poverty line is calculated so that it will be more accurate. 60% of poor households live in self-owned properties and 90% of them did not have any mortgage. I think it reflects the fact that for persons aged 60 to 64, some of them are asset rich. So should we just calculate the poverty rate by the earnings? Because it would be inaccurate. So, Undersecretary, would you consider following up on the matter with these persons aged 60 to 64? So, for example, for elderly persons living in self-owned properties, have they participated in any annuity plans or do they face any pressure from paying for living expenses? Well, I'll defer to my colleagues to take your question, because the poverty line was set by the Commissioner of Poverty back then. And in order to understand the poverty situation in Hong Kong, we need to compare with other places in the world. Previously, we explained at the panel on welfare services that, well, let me put it this way. For Hong Kong, we should adopt the concept of relative poverty in dealing with the poverty situation instead of absolute poverty. So comparing to OPEC countries where they adopt the other approach, perhaps I will defer to my colleague to brief members on the setting of poverty line. Yes, basically, we base the poverty line on earnings. Now, why is it that we look at earnings instead of assets as well? As explained previously, we rely on the household expenditure survey conducted by the CNSD as the basis. Now, basically, information about assets is sensitive. The CNSD tried to collect such data, but then we received a lot of replies refusing to answer such questions. So the success rate was low, and basically it's impossible to just ask about their asset situation. Around the world, poverty lines are set on the basis of earnings without regard to assets. So I believe the same applies at the data collection stage. Now, we understand that they might be income poor but asset rich. That is why we take this approach. Let's say if the person has a self-owned property, definitely we should evaluate the self-owned property and convert it into an annuity and see if we can make the same comparison in calculating the poverty rate. So for those with self-owned properties without mortgage, this will cause a decline in the poverty rate, and this is also set out. As for annuity, the CNSD also collects such data. Mr. Ng, the Hong Kong Mortgage Corp has an annuity plan, and in compiling poverty figures, when we considered the household survey, we regard annuity as a kind of earnings. So if the elderly person takes part in an annuity plan, and because of the plan, if the elderly person receives an income from his annuity, then the income would be regarded and calculated towards the total earnings. So together with other sources of income, if the total earnings exceed the poverty line, then the household would not be regarded as a poor household. So a follow-up question. I'm concerned about the poverty report. I want to make sure that the report can truly reflect the real situation. However, the report also serves as reference in future policy formulation of the government on policy alleviation. So if we're unable to make reference to the amount of asset owned by the age bracket here, then I want to know whether other elements can be included so that you can enhance accuracy and be more targeted on tackling poverty. Let me supplement. We do understand that if we confine ourselves to calculating earnings, there might be restrictions, and that is or limitations, and that is why we have continued to improve the poverty situation reports. For example, for those regarded as poor households, we find out whether they rent a property or in public rental housing, or whether they have self-owned property that comes with a mortgage. Because in Hong Kong, real estate property is, after all, a huge amount of asset. So we will make reference to the Rates and Valuation Department and then translate the value of property into the value under an annuity plan, and then we'll consider the drop in percentage points. Of course, different groups may have different policies applicable. That is why, when formulating government policies, apart from considering the household earnings, we also considered other assets requirements. In the process, we would not only consider lifting people out of poverty, because we understand the limitations of the poverty line.
Okay, any further questions from other members? Mr. Kwok Wai Kang.
Thank you, Chairman. You've been having a hard time, Chairman. Okay, we are now looking at the Silver Age card, and now it's been extended to elderly poverty situation. I think the situation is very complicated, because when I heard what you and the government officials were talking about, I can understand that the situation is rather complicated. If you look at the information provided by the administration, it's about the income, the assets of the elderly, and also the disposable income and expenses and so on. So my impression is that all that has been done by the administration has not been adequate. Okay, it's not that easy for you to get hold of such information in the first place, because they don't have to tell you all. So we all understand it. But then I'd like to go back to things that are more close to reality. It's not that some of these elders do not have money. For example, they might have properties, they might have income, some might even have assistance or the subsidy or the LIFA. Well, with the growing longevity, sometimes it's hard for you to know when you're going to die. And therefore, they might be worried that if I spend the money today, then by the time when I need it, I wouldn't be able to have access to the money that I need for the major operation that I need to undergo, or seeing the doctor and so on. That's the reason why they might prefer to save up the money for future uses. So it's for rainy days. That's the reason why we've been asking for a comprehensive retirement protection, so that our elders will then know that even if they spend the money that they have, they don't have to worry about what's going to happen in the future. And under the government's arrangement, in fact, for the OALA, the coverage is not that poor, because most people would be able to get it. So over 75% of them are eligible. Still, they will have to undergo this means test. So it's still not that every one of them will be eligible. And you've also said that by 2069, one in every three citizens will be an elder. So whatever happens, our decision should not be affected by this figure, because we have to respect the elderly in particular. These are people who have made tremendous contribution to our society, and therefore we should try as far as possible to make sure that by the time when they grow old, they can be assured that they don't have to worry about making ends meet. So has the government done enough? Are there any things else that they can do in order to enhance this reassurance for those working at the front line, and for those who have day-to-day contacts with them? Well, can we just translate these into figures? Or is it that they have not been able to know what's happening on the ground? How can we make sure that they will understand better, and then they can come up with more pragmatic measures that can address their needs? Yes. Well, Chairman, indeed, for people who are living longer now, and as a result, they have a lot of anxieties. We understand that. Well, we have had a lot of discussions because some mainland organizations have also received inquiries. That is, back in the 90s, they thought that with $1 to $2 million, then they would be able to enjoy the retirement life. But then with the increase or inflation of prices, even if they have $2 million, they would not be able to sustain that long. And in the end, they will have to come back to Hong Kong, and they will have to go to the hospital for a body check, and then they will have to go into some of the RCHEs in Hong Kong. So that's the situation, because the average life expectancy in Hong Kong is getting longer. That's the reason why they have these anxieties. And in response to that, we have two approaches. As the chair said, we have this annuity plan, because other than the fact that they can choose the maturity, and they can also choose to go for the lifelong annuity plan. And then for OALA, we are now reviewing the assets limit for OALA. So overall speaking, we are looking into that. And the two added together, relatively speaking, for the elderly population, we would be able to afford them with better protection other than the healthcare protection. Because with regard to retirement arrangements for individuals, you can go for different level of living, and therefore the expectation would vary. And if they'd like to make sure that they can go to the public sector for healthcare services, or if they'd like to go to the private sector for such services, is the individual's choice. Given the current resources, we just like to help these people face this problem. So, but then I agree that the problem is rather complicated. Yes, Chairman, I don't expect the administration to be able to come up with a one-size-fits-all solution. But then let's be more pragmatic. Let's look at the following. For example, the statutory retirement age. What's government's take on this? Because for the department, they normally tell you this. They don't want to restrict your employment opportunities, because we've been telling the administration that they should come up with a standard working hour, and then they would interpret it as the maximum working hours. No, that's not true. Because if they'd like to work extra, if they'd like to work overtime, then they should be eligible for OT pay. And then similarly, for standard working hours in overseas countries, you cannot ask them to retire too soon. They should be able to work until their statutory retirement age, and there is also room for maneuvering. They can extend it. So I'd like to know the administration's view on this, because there is no legislation. But then, for civil servants, there is this age limit as to when they have to retire. So the administration has been doing this, but then as far as the private market is concerned, they have not done anything at all. So what are the justifications for not taking action? Is there any room for discussion? Yes, Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. Number one, we don't have a statutory retirement age in Hong Kong. I understand that in different markets, they have different measures. And then if you like to get the OALA, and if you'd like to get labor insurance, you will have to retire by a certain age. And elsewhere, even if they have this, they are now extending it. Because globally, the life expectancy has been increasing. So I don't know what Mr. Kwok's was trying to say. So is he asking us to come up with a statutory retirement age? Well, is it necessary, and at what level or at what age should we set it? So we haven't had that discussion yet within the administration. Well, my next question might be a far cry from this, but then it's also a related issue. It has to do with the life expectancy, the average life expectancy of the population. Because in the past, we might be talking about an average life expectancy of about 70, And then by the time when you retire at 60 or 65, then I'll be living on for another 5 or 10 years. But then now, easily, you can live up to 80-something. And then if I still have to retire by 60, then I'll have to live another 20 years on my own. And then similarly, for other people, they'd be living for another 40 years, and then they'll have to live on their own means. So it's a different story when it compares to just living for another 20 years. So it's not about the meaning of having these people stay in the labor market for another 20 years. You will have to do some calculation for them. All right, they've worked very diligently throughout their life, and then by the time when they retire, will they be able to sustain a decent living for the rest of their life? And for the other support, those are the other pillars, and the administration is now putting in all the resources on this. For example, even if they are able to have their own savings or means, the administration is telling you that your own savings should be what you should be relying on. Is that the case? Mr. Kwok, you're insisting on this. That is a very common problem that we are all facing. That is, how do we define the level of service that we need? The administration will also have to reflect on this. So is there any room for improvement, and what can be done immediately so as to ease the pressure on people? Undersecretary, if you've been following up on the retirement policy, well, in fact, we're adopting this multi-pronged approach. And then, for annuity plan, an MPF, and as well as the OALA, government's support would be another pillar. And savings is, of course, another pillar, so that elders would be able to rest assured that they can enjoy their retirement life. So I'm not sure about what Mr. Kwok was saying. And what's the meaning of having this statutory retirement age? Because when they would be eligible for MPF without stating the reasons and so on. All right, we have already stipulated that. So what does that have to do with coming up with a statutory retirement age as to when they can apply for the MPF payment and so on? I think individual government policy bureaus will have their own considerations. So this is a rather complicated issue. Once you come up with a statutory retirement age for people over that age, will they still be allowed to work? And also, what kind of life plan do they have after their retirement? Should it be the government that should dictate what they have to do? So I'm not too sure about the merits of having this. Yes, Mr. Kwok? Well, yes, the administration is telling us that they do not see the link between the two. I think it's very simple. It's about doing calculation. And you might say that we're not looking at the figures, we're looking at the overarching policy, and we're looking at it from another perspective. Yes, you might feel like doing that. But then all we are saying is that they are still very anxious about it. And of course, statutory retirement age is not the only way to go about this. My question was whether or not the administration has a comprehensive look at it, or is it that they are confined to all these? They're looking at the existing framework, and all they can do is to do whatever they can within this framework, and they are not prepared to think out of the box. Well, whether or not there is a link is up to you, and you should have the full picture about this. Okay, Undersecretary, please take note of Mr. Kwok's suggestion. I think there is always a gap between what the government thinks and what we think. Yes, Mr. Vincent Chang. Good morning. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I've read the paper. It's about training for elderly people, in particular for those between 60 and 64. You talk about several things. First, for those over 60, you can have dedicated training courses so that they can have more professional skills and so on. You would also help them with restarting their business after 60. And there is also a dedicated kiosk or counter so that they can be given priority in doing the registration and so on. And also for the employment plan for senior citizens and so on. So I'd like to know a bit more about these three things. What's the progress? And also in particular for the senior citizen employment scheme, or the EPEM, that is the employment program for the elderly and middle-aged. So, can you tell us more about this? Thank you, Chairman. Well, for the EPEM, we are assisting the employers so that they can hire those over the age of 60, and they'll get some $12,000 as the allowance. But then we don't have the figures as to how many people have been employed on that basis. But then the purpose of the scheme is to encourage employers to recruit or hire people over the age of 60 in order to make better use of their skills and experience. So we can supply the figures afterwards.
What about other parts of my question about internship for those age 50 or above, called post-50s or post-50 internship program? Under Secretary. I can give you the details later. Chairman, I understand that this may not be the focus of today's meeting, but I think it is important. Over the past 2 years, as we have witnessed, the government has introduced time-limited posts, mostly for young people, for fresh graduates, professionals, whereas those in the dire straits are actually middle-aged or elderly women. They might take up manual labor jobs such as care workers or cleaners. At the same time, we'd like to improve their work environment. However, there should be support from the government for those aged 60 to 64 to rejoin the workforce and find jobs that are suitable to their age. And I understand that the employment program for the elderly and the middle-aged rolled out by the government is their highlight, but I do hope that there will be more initiatives to encourage use of your services. Well, sometimes I watch APIs on your TV. I understand your publicity effort. Basically, you encourage people not to discriminate against the aged. We should rely on meritocracy, but please step up publicity. Yes, I have information to provide now. In 2019, for the EPEM, in 2019, 3,061 applicants joined, and in 2020, 2,260, and between January and May this year, 1,186. We will continue to keep in view the situation, and if need be, we'll continue to encourage more employers to participate in the program. So the number seems really small, because we have a large population age 60 to 64. The number seems to be too small. You need to enhance publicity. Well, I can't help but feel concerned, because for those age 60 to 64, against the backdrop of an aging population, this age bracket is still growing. So on the point of aging population, the government should consider formulating relevant policies as soon as possible. I have another question for Undersecretary and his team. Because of aging population 5 years down the road, the age bracket of 60 to 64 will become senior citizens properly. I want to know whether the government has measures formulated in a timely manner for them to receive services in time. Well, I think you may be concerned about the changes in the labour market. We're past the peak of our labour shortage. We're now facing the issue of ageing population. And Chairman just asked about various supports for this age group, and it covers a wide scope. For welfare measures, the discussion can be held at the panel level. We do have residential care homes and daycare centres, and we're striving for more. About the employment of this age group, we do have some figures, such as those are already reported for EPEM. We encourage the employment of more elderly persons. Now, Chairman, what exactly is your question so that I can answer in a more accurate manner? We do have high expectations because I listened to the answers given to members' questions, and it seems that the numbers are so small and there is no targeted approach to help with improving the welfare for this age group. So the government should go back and rethink and consider the actual situation and the practical needs so that we can have a more fruitful discussion here. Any other comments? Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, second round. Thank you, Chairman. It's me again. Well, all along I've been trying to ask the administration whether it has latest information about today's topic. It is about the employment situation for the elderly. Before 2019, before the black clad violence, the unemployment rate once dropped to some 2.9%. We were in full employment. For those aged 65 or above, or even people in their 70s, they're still in employment. They were security guards, drivers, cleaners. However, with the black clad violence and emergence of COVID-19, the unemployment rate spiked. And I've heard different versions. For example, some have turned to another trade, such as security guards. Well, casual work, of course, is one category, but many of them have turned to become security guards. And according to labor unions, many people have been driven out of their original industry and have become security guards. Now, previously, security guards were usually taken up by those aged 65 or above, but now with younger, fresher blood in the workforce, I am wondering if more aged workers would be driven out of market. They used to have a job, but now they need to be worried, because they may have lost a job, they may have a drop in their income, and they might be more concerned about their retirement planning. So I wonder if you have this information, Undersecretary. Now, if a member would like to ask about unemployment or employment issues, let me give you this information. The Labour Department received figures relating to employment arrangements. In 2020, we received 41,180 applicants registering with us for seeking jobs. For those above 60 years old, the figure was 4,338, some 10%. And that's the number of persons or mature persons registered with us on the job as job seekers. Now, for referrals by Labour Department, as you know, this is one way. Instead of contacting the employers directly, we have 634 cases involving mature job seekers. And total job seekers now stood at 22,284, and 10.6%, that is 2,359 of them, were mature job seekers above 60. For referrals, we received 90%. So about the EPEM, as member just mentioned, some 4,000 job seekers were registered in 2020. As for EPEM, 2,260 jobs were offered. So is it true that the unemployment rate is high? What we see may be different if we look at another set of figures. Mr. Kwok. Well, it's not what I'm asking. According to the Undersecretary's reply, he referred to figures from the Labour Department, the number of job seekers, the age distribution. But I was asking a rather tricky question, I'm sorry. My question was whether you have information about aged employees leaving the workforce prematurely because of changes in the job market and the economic structure. It's a tricky question, but I'm concerned. I wonder if the administration will collect this data, because for these people originally, they might wanted to stay in the workforce for a number of years before retiring. Now they need to be retire prematurely. And the concern is simply, how are they going to tie them over after retirement? Mr. Ng would take this question about different age groups, employment or unemployment situation. In our household survey of the CSD, we have analyses. As per Mr. Kwok Wai Kong's question, let me give you some information. For second quarter of 2020, if we compare that with the first quarter of 2021, and if we compare the number of employees at the age of 60 to 64 to consider the impact on this age group because of the epidemic or the latest situation, indeed for those aged 60 to 64, in the second quarter of 2020, the unemployment rate was about 7%. And then in the first quarter of 2021, the unemployment rate for this age bracket indeed increased 7.5%. As for the number of employees, I would say that the number of employees increased in the second quarter of 2020, it was about 257,400. And then in the first quarter of 2021, the figure rose to 264,300, registering an increase. So that's for those aged 60 to 64. At the same time, the unemployment rate also increased from 19,400 to 21,500 between these two quarters. So despite the epidemic, it seems for this age group, they still wish to join the workforce, and the labor participation rate remained at about 48.6%. Yes, I know Hong Kong people are really keen to go to work. I think we should wrap up this item because I think members are more concerned about the two ensuing items. We expect to complete the discussion of this item in 30 minutes. I think it's about time. I thank members for your participation. The next item is consumption patterns of persons aged 60 to 64 in Hong Kong and business opportunity of the Silver Age market. Again, this is a matter close to the heart of members, and I was asked by members when I met with the Secretary to ask the administration to provide more information. So let me invite them in. We have Ms. Ada Wong, Chief Social Work Officer, Elderly One Social Welfare Department. And from the Hong Kong MC Annuity Limited, Mr. Sunny Yong, Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer. And HKMC Insurance Limited, Mr. Clement Chan, Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer. The LegCo has also prepared an information note that is CB bracket 21212/2021/04. So without further ado, I will invite the Social Welfare Department representatives to walk us through the administration's paper, CB bracket 21212/2021/03. The floor will be open afterwards. So I'll give the floor to SWD now. Thank you. The administration has prepared a paper on the consumption patterns of households with persons aged 60 to 64 provided by the CNSD, the implementation progress of the Hong Kong MC annuity plan and reverse mortgage program, as well as information on the senior citizens card scheme. The senior citizen card scheme was launched in 1994. For cards to be issued to eligible Hong Kong residents aged 65 or above as a generally recognized proof of age, allowing the cardholders to enjoy conveniently the concessions, discounts, priority services offered by government departments and private companies, etc. However, the card itself does not carry any benefits. Relevant concessions and discounts are offered by cardholders by the participating organizations. As at the May 2021, there were over 2,700 organizations and companies participating in the scheme, involving a total of 9,500 outlets and about 1.35 million senior citizen cardholders, covering about 90% overall eligible elderly persons. We have invited the Hong Kong MC and Hong Kong MC Insurance Limited to answer questions from members on the HKMC annuity plan and the reverse mortgage scheme. I'll be happy to take questions from members.
John.
Okay, we can now open the floor to members because members are very concerned about this, and you may now raise your hands to ask questions. Yes, Vincent Cheng. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to welcome the administration and also the HKMC Annuity Limited, as well as the HKMC I7 representatives here. First, I'd like to know more about the RMP, the Reverse Mortgage Program, because it's been in place for quite a while, and in the past, some elderly owners would just mortgage their properties in order to enjoy a better retirement life. I think it's been quite popular amongst the elders. I understand that there are some 4,000 such cases, and on average, this year, the number of applications has increased by some 30%. So what's your take on this? Because it's been in operation for some time. How effective has it been? And are you going to introduce more enhancement measures? Because in these last couple of years, what were the rent control measures introduced for subdivided flats? Well, in the past, subdivided flat owners would also be competing with you for customers. So under the RMP, are there going to be new initiatives in order to encourage more people to mortgage their flats with you? So first of all, this is what I'd like to know more. Okay, Mr. Chen. Yes, thank you, Mr. Cheng, for your questions. First, on RMP, since its launch in 2011, now we have 4,700 applications. And this year, we can see, well, of course, last year, because of the pandemic, our business slowed down a bit. Still, it remains steady. Every year, we have about 600 to 700 applications. And last year, in fact, when compared to the same period the previous year, the total number of applications increased by about 40%. And to a certain extent, there was some relief in light of the pandemic. With regard to the products of the RMP, well, over the years, we have been introducing enhancement measures, and this year is a very good timing because coming up, we're going to do some promotion activities. I don't know if you might have seen it. In fact, we have also introduced three new initiatives for retirement under the from the HKMC is the annuity plan and also the RMP. And also the insurance scheme, in order to encourage the public to have a better understanding of these products. And as far as the RMP is concerned, we can see that this business has been developing very steadily. But then I also agree with the member in the sense that in terms of promotion and publicity, we have to do more, because after all, in Chinese societies, very often owners would think that I'll have to leave my property to my descendants. And with an aging population, elders would also need more to meet their daily expenses. So for their descendants, their children, and next generation, I think offering themselves better protection would be good. And therefore, we are trying to promote our products to them. And in simple terms, first of all, after they have made an application, they'll be able to get the money very quickly, and the income would be steady because you'll be able to get the annuity as specified. And also, the duration would be very long, so that from the property, the elder can also stay in his own property until he passes away, and there is no need for him to make any repayment. So on that basis, we're going to further promote this product to them. Thank you. Well, my own impression is, I think it's a good plan. But then when compared to what you've been doing, well, on annuity plan, you've been doing a lot of publicity. But then for the RMP, apparently there is less publicity. And therefore, you will have to step up your publicity program. And also for the 600-odd applications, we are in particular more concerned about the older buildings. So are they mostly owners of older properties or what? So what kind of residential properties would see a higher number of applications for the RMP? Because by the time when that elder passes away, in the end, how are you going to deal with that property after taking over that property? Thank you. Age of that building, it ranges, it varies, because we have very new buildings all the way from to very old buildings, say 60-year-old. So on the age of the property, the average age is 30. And of course, you're talking about different types of buildings. In simple terms, if the applicant has been getting the monthly annuity, and then by the time when he passes away, well, the RMP itself is a loan, it's a mortgage loan. And therefore, for his descendants, we'll see if they'd like to get back the property, and they will enjoy priority. So they can get back the property if they repay the loan. Or if they don't, then the HKMCI will just sell the property in order to repay the loan of the elder. So that's to repay the loan that he has obtained. So in the end, you're going to sell the property. So are you going to sell that in the open market or what? Well, the lending institution will do that. And after the lending institution has sold it, depending on the price that it can fetch, let's say after the sale, if the amount is more than the loan taken out by the elder, then of course that would not be a problem. But then if there is any surplus, then that can also be paid back to his descendants. And if price fetch is lower than what he got, his surviving family does not have to repay that shortfall. But then in the end, I'd just like to know whether or not you're going to sell the property in the open market. Yes, indeed, that will be done. Okay, any further questions? Then, if none, then I'd like to ask the administration. You just talk about those from 60 to 65, the monthly average expenses, that's about the same as the average household. It's just that for healthcare expenses, that would be on the high side. That's a problem. So I'd like to know what's meant by medical services. What type of services are they getting? Next, with regard to the age-dependent requirements, so have you considered expanding medical or healthcare insurance coverage for them so that they can get free or subsidized healthcare services so that they can get early treatment? So I'd like to know more about these two. Who can answer? Yes, SWD. Yes, concerning medical services, what it covers. Well, sorry. The CNS department did not give us the detailed information. But then we can make a comparison for the household general expenditure. Well, on medical expenses, the monthly is $777. And then for those with family members aged 60 to 64, is $914. So on average, it's 18% higher. So from this, we can see that when compared to other types of expenditure, there is a bigger gap. Otherwise, for the other items of expenditure, they would be more or less the same. So is there a way, or is it possible for the administration to target this group of cohorts so that you can offer body checks and so on in order to help them? Yes, earlier on, I remember there was a meeting on this. That is for medical services for those aged 60 to 64. Well, that's under the FHB. So we can pass this on to them so that they can take follow-up action on this. Yes, because from the report, my personal concern is that for this age cohort, can they get appropriate services? Because given the aging population, the situation will only get worse. And very often, these people would be neglected. In particular, in our society, there isn't anything concrete to help them. But then they have already retired. And therefore, thanks to the SWD, I hope that you can pass this on to the FHB so that in terms of policy arrangements, you will have to take care of these neglected people. Next, Vincent Chang. Thank you, Chairman. In the paper, you talk about the senior citizen card scheme. It's been in place for many years. It was first launched in 1994 and has been offered to those aged 65 or above. And they can enjoy special services or discounts by government departments or public organizations and other companies and so on. And by 2021 May, there were over 2,700 organizations participating with over 9,500 outlets. I think it's a good thing, and now you're giving it a new name. So that's called the Joyous Card, the Joyous Card. So for senior citizen card scheme, it's for those age over 65. And later on, you're trying to convert that with the other card. And then you can use the Octopus card approach. And then there are other smart cards. So I think you're going to launch it this year. And then by February next year, for those age 60 to 65, they can already apply. So have you got plans for those age 60 and over? Would there be any change to this senior citizen cards? On this, in fact, the Bureau Director already said that for the individual Octopus cards, they would also cover some functions of the senior citizen cards because under the transport fare concession scheme for the personal Octopus cards design, the theory, the concept is that they can also replace the senior citizen cards later. So that for those over 65, once they have applied for this personalized Octopus card, then we can have this Octopus card and the design will be more or less the same as the senior citizen cards right now. And the purpose is that for those over 65 in the future, they can use this personalized Octopus cards and then they can have all the functions of the current senior citizen cards. But of course, that there'll be a transitional period. In particular, for those over 65, they will also have to apply for this personalized Octopus cards. And we are talking about over 1.38 million senior citizens, and therefore it will take a bit longer for us to complete the process. But we do expect that by 2024, for the time being, we plan that we will be suspending the current senior citizen cards. And then for the $2 transport fare scheme, we will be suspending it. And then for people using the new personalized Octopus cards, they will still be enjoying the discount. And through promoting the current concessions offered by merchants and so on, well, we haven't got the timetable yet, but then we have got the plan in place. And after the new plan is in place, we will help promote the personalized Octopus cards. And we will also encourage more merchandisers to offer more concessions to this age cohort. I think the timetable is very compressed because by 2024, you'll be rolling that out and there isn't much time to go. And therefore, I hope that the SWD can do things in tandem. For example, for the 2,700 outlets and over 9,500 outlets, can you tell them that they should be allowed to use the personalized Octopus cards and so on, so that you can expand the scope, and then you can encourage more people to use that Octopus cards? Because right now, for the consumption coupon scheme, well, you have $5,000, and you should also make use of the media, because during the past couple of months, many senior citizens would be attracted. And you also have these e-payment systems and so on. You will have to work a bit harder so that 1 year down the road, we will have many initiatives in place to encourage them to use it. I think Mr. Chang was asking this question, and that leads me to think that for the senior citizen cards, they are very popular. According to your reports, you have 1.35 million senior citizen card holders, accounting for some 90% of the overall eligible elderly persons. But then if you look at the number of organizations and so on, there are only 2,700 participating. So there is room for improvement. And therefore, my question is, other than what Mr. Vincent Chang just asked, SWD people, have you been working consistently to encourage more shops and operators, and have you been offering incentives for them to take part in this scheme? I think that's the emphasis.
You need to understand that with the launch of the Joyu card, the senior citizen cards may have a different position here. So have you been working on that? Well, we'd like to enhance the function of the senior citizen card, so through various channels such as publicity in the media and other shops and organizations, we hope to provide more concessions and discounts to senior citizens. And the SWD has an office, and every year we would negotiate with companies that are related to senior citizens, such as registered Western and Chinese medical practitioners, restaurants, etc. And on a regular basis, we have different publicity efforts, such as APIs on radio, TV, and also bus advertisements. For example, last year on the 15th of November, it was the Senior Citizen Day, and we also organize an activity inviting organizations and companies to provide special concessions and discounts to senior citizens. And 1,400 shops across the territory joined our scheme so that senior citizens could have a fresh experience. So I would say that we've continued to mount publicity. Please note to our reply. So if there are no other questions, I'm going to wrap up this item. Mr. Vincent Chang, I see that the CEO of the Hong Kong MC Annuity is also here. I have a question for him, because in recent years they have done a lot. And according to your report, the premium rose by about 20% per year. So I'd like to know whether you have new initiative for this year. Are you going to encourage more to participate in annuity plans? Thank you, member, for your question. We have been promoting annuity in the recent years, and also longevity risk management. And in 2020, despite COVID-19, and in fact that dealt a blow to the whole insurance sector, but annuity sales increased by 56%. In the first half of this year, 2021, the sales volume continued to increase. Comparing to the first half of last year, we registered a 70% growth. And we work on different fronts. For example, the Hong Kong MC Retire 3, as Mr. Chen just mentioned, it has just been launched. We have another new promotion. We encourage members of the public to convert the MPF contributions to annuity savings by offering a 2% discount. There is no need to withdraw anything from the MPF accounts. All they need is to provide a proof of their MPF statement After checking the sums, we will provide the discount. There will be other publicity efforts. We're going to visit organizations, larger establishments with more employees, and we'll brief them on our products, and if they're interested, we'll offer discounts. It's an ongoing effort. I support that because I think the HKMC has done a lot of publicity, enhancing public's awareness of your products. But then the focus here is the age bracket 60 to 64. There is a lot of potential. I hope you will come up with more plans to help them improve the living condition. All right, if there are no other views, I'm going to wrap up this item. Once again, I thank the three representatives for attending our meeting. Item 3, progress of incorporating persons aged 60 to 64 under the Government Public Transport Fare Concession Scheme for the elderly and eligible persons with disabilities. We have a paper from the administration, CB2128/2021/01. The LegCo Secretariat has also prepared an information note for your reference, CB2128/2021/01. Now, through the panel on welfare services, we have invited members to take part in the discussion of this item as well. And we have with us Dr. Lau Chi Kwong, Secretary for Labour and Welfare, and his team. I'm going to invite the administration to walk us through the paper, and then the floor will be open for Q&A. So over to you, Dr. Lau. Thank you, Chair. The Labour and Welfare Bureau held a press conference earlier to explain the arrangement to the public. Earlier, we also answered members' questions here on our arrangement. So I'm going to give a few salient points. As you know, one important element of the scheme is that the age limit will be lowered from 65 to 60. And the previous review, we decided that the scheme will now cover red minibuses and ferries and tram as well. The implementation date is 27th of February 2022, and starting from the 2nd of August, we will start receiving applications for the JoyU card, starting from those born in 1957, and then the next phase, 1958, so on and so forth. So that by 27th of February, everyone eligible for the concession would be able to and have been able to get the new card. We welcome applications
through electronic.
So over 300 plus elderly district elderly centers and also the social centers for the elderly would also be helping. So the whole arrangements are that the YoYo card, the YoJoy card is an auto service card, and therefore you will also have to make a deposit for applying for that. But then on this occasion, the $50 refundable deposit will be waived.
After successfully obtaining the JoyU card, it has to be activated, and $10 is a refundable deposit. As for the other group, elderly persons aged 65 or above, starting from the beginning of next year, depending on the experience in the coming month, we will make announcements about the arrangements for them to apply for a JoyU card. In the long term, for elderly persons above the age of 60, they will be using the JoyU cards only in the future. But during the run-in period, because of the huge population size, about from 1 million of elderly people, we need to make arrangements, and details will be announced later. Thank you, Secretary. A very succinct presentation. Let me first invite Mr. Vincent Chang to take the floor. First, we have been craning our necks for the Joyu card to be launched. I understand that after applying for one, you can use it right away. I want to know whether you can compress the timetable. You will be explaining to me, of course, that there are different difficulties. I just want to know whether you can speed up the process. That's the first question. Second, if I remember correctly, you can use either the Octopus app or you can get a form and then mail the form back to the department. Of course, some elderly would choose the Octopus app, but for those with without the technical know-how, would you ask the MTR stations to help, or perhaps your offices? Distribution points, in other words, so and collection boxes to facilitate their application, because after all, it sounds quite cumbersome to go to the post office. Secretary, at this stage, we're talking about people aged 60 to 64. I don't think it'd be very difficult to process the application electronically. For the majority of those aged 60 to 64, especially as we can draw on the reference of applying for consumption voucher schemes, over 330 outlets are set up for distributing forms. Of course, you can also mail the form back to you, but not MTR stations, right? I'm sorry, they can only send back by post. My point is whether the MTR stations can be deployed for distributing and collecting forms. Right, why don't you walk the extra mile and avoid criticisms from by the public? In fact, post boxes are convenient. Well, Secretary, you should you should put yourself in the shoes of elderly, because you still have another group of beneficiaries. I don't think it's a comprehensive plan if you only allow return of forms by post. About compressing the timetable, I would say it's risky, because it must be done in an orderly fashion and the information dissemination should be clear. Say for each age group, if I compress the timetable by 7 days, that means the 2nd of August to 20th of, the 20th of August, and then next group starting from the 21st of August, so on and so forth, then it would be very confusing. And our undertaking is to process the application within 4 weeks. Let's not forget that for each age group, there would be more than 100,000 eligible applicants. So we cannot be overly aggressive in processing applications. We have estimated the time needed for processing applications, and I would say the current timetable is just right. Any other questions, Mr. Kwok Wai Kong? Thank you, Chairman. Time flies. It was Mr. Wong Kok Hing who first floated the idea of expanding the concession scheme to cover those aged 60 to 64. And now, very soon, we will see the launch of Joyu Card. What a delight. Of course, we'd like to speed up the process. It's only normal to think so. I think the department is ready as well. My concern isn't about the timetable, however, it's about coverage. It said that for Kaito trams and red minibuses, they will also be covered. And I welcome this approach. And I live on the island side. I am more concerned about trams. In the past, in the $2 concession scheme, trams are not covered. So trams don't enjoy the pricing edge anymore, because when comparing to other forms of transport, the fare levels are just the same. then the trams don't have an edge. For those age 60 or above at the moment, the tram fare is $2 or so. So they save just several dozen cents. My concern is that you will undermine the interest of trams. Because of the expansion of the $2 scheme, they no longer enjoy an edge. Now, according to Mr. Wong Kwok-hing's original proposal, those aged 60 to 64 or those aged 65 or above, they should be able to ride trams for free. Only by putting this in place would we truly offering concessions to elderly so that we can preserve the edge of the tram company and preserve tram as a whole, because otherwise the operating environment would be getting worse for trams, because relatively speaking it's not air conditioned and it travels quite slowly, so it's losing out to other forms of transport already. Why is it that despite all these opinions the government is still insisting on $2?
Yes, son. As you know, for those over 65, if they take the tram, they're paying 120. And therefore, relatively speaking, when compared to other forms of public transport, they have to pay $2. So for the 120 that they have to pay, well, at present, the normal fare for trams would be 260. So it's already quite a far cry from other forms of public transport. If that's to be lowered to 260, why have we not considered the fare for tram? If it's not applicable to tram, then they'll be paying 260, and then for the other forms of transport, they'll be paying $2. So relatively speaking, the tram will be disadvantaged. So by lowering it to 60, including trams, that would be a necessity, or else there will be a negative impact on tram services. And of course, the advantage of tram is that it's not just about the fare. I think the biggest advantage is that, they are running on the tracks, and then they are slow moving, and then people will be able to enjoy a very slow ride. And then if that's included in the new fare, by lowering the age eligibility to 60, we just want to make sure that there'll be no negative impact on tram services. That's all. Okay, you're going to include tram services, and that's one of the considerations. Yes, I have noted that. But then, honestly, you haven't been able to resolve all the problems by doing this, because whether it's buses or other forms of transport, because of the $2 fare, the subsidy from the administration will be substantial. But then for trams, given the current situation, I think covering them is good. But then what is going to happen is that for the patronage loss, it will not be able to make up for the 60 cents that they get from you in the form of subsidy. So there is this discrepancy. And indeed, on the one hand, how can tram continue to serve Hong Kong? Second, we also hope that the elders can also get better concession from trams. Is that possible? Bureau Director, yes, when it comes to public transport policy, we have to consider many factors. On this occasion, the adjustment and also after the launching of the new fare concession scheme, will that affect the patronage for different forms of transport? We still have to look into it. But then the current situation is that we'd like to make it clear. And if you like to introduce more complicated measures so that in different forms of public transport, if the fare is different, then the situation will become unduly complicated. And therefore, from the policy perspective and also in terms of communicating with the public, we'd just like to make things simple, or else this form of transport will give you some extra benefit or extra concession. I think that the current scheme is more simple and easy to understand. As to what you just said, we will look into it. Okay, we'll look into it later. Okay, I have several questions. In fact, I've been very concerned about those age 60 to 64. I am concerned about their welfare. And through different occasions, we've been reflecting that to the Bureau Director. And if you ask me, I have several concerns, and I hope that you can address them. Well, it's been introduced after much cost because it was announced in 2020, and it will only come into effect next year. We understand that because you also have to have risk management. But then when you announced it in July, since then, what kind of publicity strategy have you adopted? In fact, it has not been very aggressive because when we go to the district, very often they would ask us, well, when will it be launched? How do they make applications and so on? So you will have to make sure that you would launch a more simple and easy to understand publicity. That's point number one. Second, well, through the mobile apps of the Autopass card or through postal services, they can also download the form from your website and so on. I think those are the ways to do it. But then for the application forms, that is the paper forms, you will also you can also place them with the housing estate's management office, because every housing estate has a management office, and therefore you will have to make sure that they can get the application forms very easily, because it's just a way of distributing the paper application forms, right? Third, for the JoyU card, I think it's like what the DAB has been asking. Well, we've been asking for the Silver Age card. And I think you can increase the functions as of the JoyU card, for example. Other in-kind benefits can also be included. For example, the D of H District Elderly Centers members, they can also have such information encrypted into the JoyU card so that you can use one card and then you can use it for different purposes. For example, you have different mobile apps, for example, the IM Smart card and so on. So is it possible for you to increase the functions of this JoyU card so that it can have multi-functions? Well, it may not be possible right now, but then can it be done in the future? And also, are there better ways to ensure that people will not be abusing the use of that card? Because society as a whole is very concerned about this, because you're talking about public money. So as a policy bureau, do you have specific planning for this? Bureau Director. Thank you, Chairman. Well, of course, if it has more functions, it's better. Well, we have already over 300 such centers. And if I remember it correctly, when it comes to the distribution of services, over 95% of the elders will be going to about 200 meters from their home to get the service. And if they have to move further, well, of course, in the rural areas, well, they will have to walk a bit farther. And then even if we introduce what you said just now, it may not be able to help. And therefore, if you look at the operational perspective, the more outlets there are, the more application forms will be wasted. So it may not be a big problem. These are things that have to be taken on board. You cannot just overprint the number of application forms, because we're not sure how many people will be using the paper forms, in particular for those aged 60 to 64. Generally speaking, the IT take-up rate is high. Yes, what I'm telling you is that for these consumption coupons, the $5,000 coupons, well, when we do it on the ground for those over 60, well, I think there are still quite a number of them using paper forms. And of course, I can understand why you're distributing them at district elderly centers and so on. But then if you maintain the 200 meter radius, that's reasonable. Still, if you can extend it a bit further, that's not bad. I think the administration should be willing to take on board different suggestions, because for housing estate officers, I think in every estate you have one office, and then you can just try to do that. Okay, we can consider it. We'll go back and take a look. Well, just now you also discussed the senior citizens card. I'd just like to supplement. Our attitude is that, well, we all know that senior citizens card would be issued by the government, and the only function that it serves is to enable other operators would be able to use that to identify that cardholder to be a senior citizen. So all we've been doing is that we would issue the card to ensure the authenticity of age of the cardholder, whether or not the picture is the same as the cardholder. So that's for the merchandiser to recognize the cardholder. And in terms of promoting the use of the senior citizen card, of course, we do have a role. That is, we can encourage the operators to offer the concession, but then still, it's up to the operator to decide. I believe that in the future, once almost all age over 60 have this JOYU card, then we will have to consider whether or not we can use one card to do all, including the functions of the senior citizen card. For example, the JOYU card also carries a picture and also is also issued through a government authorized or recognized procedure. And therefore, in terms of the concept and in terms of the function, it can replace the senior citizen card. But then in the end, are shop operators willing to offer such concessions to those age 60 to 65 other than those age 65 or above? That's up to them. So we'll see how things go. And then on the prevention of abuse, in fact, for the JOYU card, we have the picture and also the name of the cardholder, and in the design, it's easy to identify. And the whole purpose is to provide the a way for people to see if the cardholder is indeed the one that is shown on the card. Because we have to make sure that we can authenticate the identity of the cardholder. And on abuse of the card, I think with that card, it's easier. But then the number of JOYU card holders will increase, and we will have to see how we can improve or enhance the ways of prevention of abuse. Okay, Mr. Vincent Chang, further questions? Yes, thank you. I think my question is similar to the one asked by you, Chairman. It's about the abuse situation. In the past, as you said, one of the reasons why you were hesitant in launching this card was that you were concerned about possible abuse. And now that you have a picture of that card, and if he genuinely wants to cheat, he will still be able to do so because he just holds the card, and then it's very difficult to check the card against his look. And what if you abuse the card, if you use other people's cards, you will have to step up publicity in order to make sure that people will understand the implications. And also, I suspect that many people will be using it. And you said that shop operators will have to support it. Well, for those aged 60 to 64, their consumption power is still very high. And earlier on, we just discussed it. It's about the senior citizen card arrangements. And Ms. Wong from the SWD said that several thousand people might be applying, and arrangements can be put in place, and you should be doing things in tandem. You can compress the whole process in order to ensure that by the time people reach 60, they can do it. They can just apply for this. So in terms of the timeline and how you can synchronize everything, can you tell us more? Yes, I'll defer to my colleague to supplement. But then on this issue, as I said, the current senior citizen card would be for people over 65. And for 60 to 64, we have about 1.4 million people. And if we were to replace the senior citizen card with another card, it's a different story. And then early next year, we'll be announcing the details of the application procedures. And depending on the experience this time, we will look at how we can convert the future senior citizen card to the Joy Yukata. So I was saying that some 1.4 million people will be eligible. So it's about twice the number of those aged 60 to 64. And in particular, for those over 65, we can people may be very old in age, all the way up to over 100. And therefore, the arrangements might not be that expeditious. So we will have to look at the feasibility of this. Yes, we all want to do it as soon as possible, because there is no reason why we should stall. So we'll be monitoring the program very carefully, but then there are some difficulties for me to make an undertaking as to when we can complete that for those age over 65. We'd just like to do it one thing at a time, because we don't want to make cause confusion, because senior citizens might be confused as to when they could replace their senior citizen card with the Joy U card. We will have to make things simple and easy to understand, so that we don't want different cards to be in use simultaneously in the society, in the community, causing confusion.
Assistant Commissioner, in terms of monitoring, we do have measures to tackle abuse with the operators such as MTRCL and franchise bus companies. We used to mount joint operations. We're going to step up the frequency of these operations. And like the Secretary said, with the card as identification, it would be easy for law enforcement authorities to check the identity of the user and tackle abuse. For, say, if you take land transport, you have a driver, and if you tap the card very easily, the driver could check your appearance, and it would be difficult to abuse the system. Whereas for MTR, people would just go through the turnstile with the card, and we have different forms of identification, such as the flashing of lights, and we also have a dedicated enforcement team. And as you may have read in previous reports, offenders would be caught, which would result in fines or other forms of legal consequence. So we will step up our monitoring of use by those age 60 to 64. But abuse is very prevalent. So if you say we have a card with bearing a photo, does it mean that it would be easier to identify offenders? I mean, 20 years ago, we already established a system for beeping sound to go off when one goes through the turnstile using these cards. So I don't think that's a valid way. Assistant Commissioner. Well, we did keep in view the situation with operators such as MTRCL. When going through the turnstile, a beeping sound would go off, and the MTRCL, in fact, has put in more resources now. Once the alarm goes off, their colleagues would conduct checks. But I wouldn't say that it's foolproof. We just reviewed the system and consider that it has, to a certain extent, deterrence. But like Mr. Vincent Cheng said, we'll continue to keep in view whether there are other ways and other technologies available for conducting checks. I do have another question. In relation to the anti-abuse measures, like the Transport Department referred to the MTRCL, what about other forms of transport such as ferries, buses? Do you have concrete guidelines for the operators so that you can tackle abuse by means of, for example, having additional manpower? How can we be reassured that there won't be a repeat of the abuse? Like I said, the Transport Department would mount joint operations with the operators. And we also conduct surprise checks on whether the operators are conducting checks as well. As for buses, I think we have members of the public, other passengers, as well as drivers helping to catch the offenders. Say if a young person is using a Joyo card to board a bus. So there are ways to help the operators identify offenders. As for the MTR, apart from the beeping of the turnstile, we would discuss with them and see whether they could step up surveillance by having additional manpower. For Joyo card, it's a form of identification. It's a form of proof, you could put it this way, that could facilitate enforcement as well as prosecution. And we'll continue to monitor the situation after implementation of Joyo card. Mr. Vincent Chang. May I start a discussion on this point? It's a very important policy issue. In terms of social resources, utilization will often lead to abuse, and that is why the government must come up with ways to prevent abuse. But if you want to totally eradicate the problem to make it foolproof, we need to consider a major concern, that is privacy. So if you ask whether there is technology available to tackle abuse, of course there is. I can come up with ways right off the top of my head to catch the offender. But in terms of privacy, it should be handled with sensitivity. The other point is about the investment of hardware and software and whether it's disproportionate. Consider a foolproof method if you just consider the technology. For example, anyone who uses this card will have their data transmitted to, say, a centralized station for comparing their facial features, etc. And imagine the extent of investment and the concern over privacy matters. So it's a balancing exercise as we try to prevent abuse as well as facilitating genuine users. For example, of course, we hope everyone would abide by the law. And we have rules and regulations in place, only that definitely and inevitably this would restrict the liberty and rights of individuals. So it's about striking a balance. I understand that, Secretary. Of course, nothing is foolproof. But from what I've read, I would say that the situation of abuse is quite rampant. But I don't think I've heard anything innovative from the Secretary's answer. You may cite privacy concerns, etc. There must be a way to overcome this. For example, if you find somebody using the card that bears a photo which does not resemble that person's appearance, then the card should be banned for use for 3 months. So administratively, I wonder if more can be done. The financial penalty ranges from $2,000 to $5,000. And it also attracts an imprisonment term. So I would say that the punishment is deterrent enough. I would say that the fines are already rigorous. I do agree that to a certain extent we need to strike a balance, but we cannot allow loopholes to exist. Now, members, the Secretary hasn't answered my question on overall publicity. Any views, Secretary? We have APIs on TVs and other publicity efforts. We're going to broadcast APIs. We're going to do explanation on radio programs. We are also going to put up posters and distribute leaflets at housing estates. Meanwhile, one should not underestimate the social network of those aged 60 to 64. Like members said, we've all been waiting for the launch of the card for a long time. Of course, it will capture everyone's attention, but we will continue to make the best effort. What about the online channel? Pay attention to that as well. If there are no other views from members, I will wrap up the item. But I do have a number of points under AOB. First, we have a visit. Let me remind members that next week, next Tuesday on the 20th of July from 9:30 a.m. to 1 p.m., we're going to visit Jockey Club Age at Home, Jerome Tech Education and Rental Service Center. Mr. Leung Chee Cheong, Mr. Kwok Wai Kung, and Mr. Vincent Chang will be participating in this visit. The organizer will be receiving us, and that is the Hong Kong Council of Social Services and the cooperating organizations, the Hong Kong Red Cross and Lutheran Social Service and the St. James Settlement. The administration is not going to send representatives to this visit, and I am aghast because the administration should take part in our activity as well. Any views? If I ask the secretary to invite the administration again, I agree, because it's supposed to be an opportunity of exchange, and we'd like to facilitate exchange, and we'd like to ask the government to follow up on the matters as well. Right, I'll ask the secretary to follow up on it. If necessary, we'll approach the administration again. And about the future direction of the subcommittee, we've had a number of meetings and we have discussed the 8 issues close to the heart of members, and basically we have completed the discussion of these items. And I'd like to ask members whether it is necessary to call for other meetings and whether there are other items that we would like to make proposals to the administration. So views are welcome, and if there are no other outstanding items, this will be the last meeting of the subcommittee. I'm grateful to our members of the subcommittee for your support, and after receiving the administration's response via the secretariat, we will follow up on them. And if you have other views, do submit them to the secretariat. The secretariat will compile a report for the subcommittee for members for circulation to members for your consideration and endorsement. The report will then be submitted to the panel on welfare services. So this will be the last meeting, is that right? I agree. The highlight of the subcommittee here is to handle the situation about Joy U Card. We've been waiting for its launch, and I think we are at the home stretch now. For the new term of LegCo, we should wait for the new members to take up their duties and then deal with the rest of the matters regarding the Silver Age card. All right, if there are other comments, they will be circulated so that we continue to have interaction with the administration. If there are no other questions, this is our last meeting of the subcommittee on issues relating to the Silver Age card. And once again, I thank members for your support and your invaluable views, and I will further invite the administration to respond to the issues raised by members. There is nothing else under AOB. Meetings adjourned. Thank you.